Okay, so obviously we are flying. As usual, the TX-16S Max from Radio Master. As you can see down on that bottom center of the screen there, we're flying the Aerowing Pro with a 4S3P 18650 battery pack from Cluosi. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. It's a NCR18650GA sales. These are the cheap ones that I posted about on the community tab recently that picked up from AliExpress. And this is actually the first time I'm going to get to try them out and see how they perform in the air. So we're just kind of flying right now. I'm going to get up to about 300 or so feet just to... we don't need to be real high. I'm not shooting for any kind of major distance or anything right now. We're just kind of circling the field south of here. I can kind of see out the door there. And we're just going to kind of keep it in the area and fly. It's currently 4:38 p.m. I'm hoping I'm able to run the battery all the way down before dark. The sun should be setting in about an hour and a half from now, which should pretty much coincide with about how long I expect to be able to keep the airplane in the air. Now this is a 10,500 milliamp hour battery pack, and you see we're cruising at less than 5 amps, or right about 5 amps, we'll call it about 5. So in theory we should be able to get about 2 hours, but while they're rated for 10,500 milliamp hours, during my testing I actually only able to get about 8,500 or so. Is a more realistic number with, you know, keeping some margin. And that's pushing them down to 3 volts per cell, which is like 12 volts. Because obviously it is a 4-cell pack. Well, there's actually 12 cells, but there's 3 banks of 4 cells each in parallel. That's how it's configured. So I'm aiming to get about 8,500 or so out of it is about the maximum that I'm going to want to push it. So, I'd say an hour and a half plus maybe a little bit more is a little bit more realistic number. So, just kind of going back over things right now. I'm taking note of my GPS. We have 14 satellites locked right now. We're doing 45 miles an hour cruise at about 5 amps. Now my efficiency number right now is down around 110 or so milliamp hours. It's kind of bouncing around anywhere from 100 to 125, right in that range. Let's call it about 115. But you can see there we have a little bit of a crosswind at 4.7 miles an hour crosswind according to RGPilot. Some nice cloud formations up ahead there. We actually had a little bit of clouds pushed through earlier. And I thought it might rain and kind of ruin my chances to do this. Because like I said, the weather lately has been really, really not cooperative and less than ideal. A lot of cold and wind and rain and everything. You see there's water standing everywhere out here. There, you know, nothing's really had a chance to dry yet. But today is relatively calm. Like I said there, we have about a 5 mile an hour tailwind pushing us right now. And it's about 72, 73 degrees outside. I actually just launched the airplane in shorts. So I know some of you in the winter climates are a little bit jealous of that, but sorry. I mean, I'm going to take advantage while I can. But no, in all seriousness, I was hoping to get to test this sooner, but this time of year is kind of hit or miss with the weather. So today we're jumping at the chance to fly. And like I said, I'm just probably going to end up skipping most of this video because it's just literally just going to be me circling round and round the fields in this area south of home for the next hour and a half or so, unless the dark catches up with us sooner. It's like I said, I was kind of waiting around for that little front that passed through today to clear out, and it should start cooling off again, which I expect it's going to be really, really calm as the day progresses, you know, closer to sunset. Once the sun sets over the horizon, it's going to get really calm. You know, if I had to guess anyway. So, we're just kind of, like I said, just out flying the AR wing, enjoying it, and we're going to see how these batteries do. But yeah, I'm just kind of watching my milliamp hour counter. You can see it's currently at 698 milliamp hours, with our 700. But I'm watching the voltage too. If the battery starts dipping down around 13 or so, I'm going to start paying close attention to it. Because, like I said, I do want to have it close enough to LAN whenever I need to. At 12 volts, I want to be basically at home and ready to land at any moment. Because it's kind of in that last little cliff where the voltage really starts to drop off quick at that point. So, yeah, I mean, we're just going to kind of circle the fields out here and see what happens. So, as you might notice, I have a little bit different layout right now. As far as my recording, what you're seeing, I'm probably going to go ahead and overlay an image right now that I took before I took off, actually, when the airplane was on the ground waiting for a GPS lock and everything. Went and snapped a quick picture. So I'm actually using a bigger monitor over here now that I'm flying with. I was previously using a little 19-inch Haier, and I replaced that with a 24-inch Philips TV that has much better image quality. In fact, I'm really happy with that. I really like the way it looks, and it's just a little bit more pleasant experience for me as a pilot. And like I said, I still have my open window out here. I can see the fields out in that area while I'm flying over. So that's a good thing. But yeah, I'm just kind of cruising around and literally in cruise mode, just letting the autopilot do most of the work for me. And we are still getting a little bit of rough air, a little turbulence and stuff like that. It's another reason I didn't fly earlier today. There was a lot of thermals out earlier in the day. There was actually some big whirlwind things, little dust tornadoes, whatever you want to call them. They were sucking up leaves as really, really high as I could see them into the air. I was out walking some of these fields, actually. I was out metal detecting. I recently got myself a new metal detector, and I've been playing around with that when it's not too muddy to walk in the field anyway. But when it's too windy to fly, I'm still cruising the fields just with a metal detector. But anyway, I thought that was kind of interesting. And one thing I'm noticing out here, this sugarcane in the field, that's what the lighter tan color is. It's sugarcane that's already matured and died and drying and everything. It's pretty much ready to cut it. I guess they're just kind of waiting on it to dry up enough for them to cut it. Not really sure why it's not cut yet. I see a vehicle out on the road here. Gonna head that way. I'm noticing the RSSI is lower than I like out here right now. Now, I'm still using the 900 megahertz Dragon Link system. It's actually really low right now, down in the 20s. But once again, this is still an early version of firmware for the 900 megahertz system. And they do intend to tweak the RSSI performance. The system performs perfectly fine, but the indicated RSSI, as far as what's given out to the OSD, is not as optimal as they would like it to be. It's not really a linear versus distance or whatever. I'm just kind of speculating here. I just know that it doesn't perform the way they want it to, and they do intend to improve that later. But in my testing on the ground, I had really good ground range tests, like 75, 80 feet or so, with everything powered up in the airplane in micro power range test mode, whatever the correct terminology that Dragon Link uses for that. Which is more than adequate and perfectly acceptable. And one thing that I also noticed is that well into like single digit RSSI, like one or two RSSI, I had never really hit any glitchy performance or failsafe or anything. And it was only after I actually had zero RSSI that the receiver finally dropped into failsafe. And like I said, that's just doing ground tests, but I expect it to perform basically the same in the air. So, another thing I'm actually flying right now, another change I made is my receiver antennas. I'm still flying with a biquad that I normally do, that's my main antenna, and it's facing kind of out in the direction that we're heading to right now, kind of southeast of home. But straight south for my secondary antenna, I'm actually using my old Hyperlink, or is it Elcom? One of the two, the same brand name. They switch names at some point, but it's a Elcom slash Hyperlink patch antenna. And it's one that I bought that was not tuned for 1280 megahertz. DPCAV sells a custom element to go inside and ReadyMade RC sells a custom tuned version of the antenna. It's two ways to get it, you know, more accurately tuned for 1280 megahertz than the way it comes default from Hyperlink or Ilcom. But mine was one that I bought direct from them and then tuned it myself later. But I just did kind of some guesswork based on Alex IB Crazy's tutorial videos on how to tune that antenna. But I'd never actually tested the antenna's performance and tuning and everything until I recently got that little Nano V&E that I made a video about recently. And that's one of the antennas that I tuned with it. I actually had to trim quite a bit more than I expected off of the active element than what was already trimmed from it. And I got it perfectly tuned now, and so that's what I'm using for my secondary antenna. And I'm not 100% sure which antenna I'm flying on right now. Actually, I'm going to walk and check that real quick. Give me just a minute. We are currently still flying on the patch, which is on my second receiver input. So we're actually flying off the side of that patch antenna right now. Get back situated properly in my chair here. But yeah, we're flying off of the side of that patch antenna right now, and it's really performing much better than I expected. Now, I'm finally starting to see a little bit of what looks like multipathing in the video. You see the video, the colors in the video were kind of changing a little bit, getting kind of weird. It's kind of doing it again, saturations, kind of doing some weird stuff. So that's a sign that you're kind of starting to get into a little bit of multipathing or something weird like that, or maybe just flying through one of the nulls on the antenna. But it's still obviously 100% flyable. But that antenna seems to be performing really well. So I expect it should probably switch over to the other antenna here pretty soon. I'm actually kind of making it a point to fly north. There it goes. And now we're back to the bike-wide antenna. So I have two really good performing antennas right now, and their beamwidth are somewhat overlapping. So my diversity controller really doesn't have much work for it to do right now. Notice a little flock of birds just passed over me there. Not even sure where they went. Guess they were just out cruising the fields like we are. But yeah, I'm noticing that both antennas are really, really locked in and stable right now. Both receivers anyway using those antennas. So I guess at this point I'm just gonna fly back towards home. Let the wind push us home, and then see if we can get it to switch back to that patch antenna. Which I guess the closer we are to the antennas, they're probably going to both be receiving perfectly fine. Especially the bi-quad has a nice, some nice little beams around. You know, they obviously don't have as much gain as flying out in front of the antenna, but you can fly all around that thing when you're close in, and it works perfectly fine. But yeah, having both of these antennas lets me have two really good stable signals that cover a wide area out here. So I guess we're going to fly out closer to home and then go straight south of home and see if we can get it to switch back. So how long have we been flying now? For 15 minutes. The recording has been going for 16 minutes. Probably going to cut part of that off. And there's, we just switched from the bi-quad back to the patch antenna. Which that came a little bit sooner than I thought it would. And now we're back. Not sure what that was about. A bit of multipathing or something like that. That's kind of the beauty of having two receivers out here. And especially on like 1280 megahertz. You really don't need them. You can fly on one receiver perfectly fine. But I have two, and the controller and everything do it. So I might as well use them. But you can really get some good rock solid performance out of your video system like that. So yeah, we're starting to get into a little bit of multipathing now. So I want to continue heading out this way, kind of southwest. So we're starting to get a little good bit of noise, and well, not really noise, but there's some multipathing, and there's the patch antenna that we were looking for. Just got it to switch back. So yeah, you can see that the diversity controller really doesn't end up hunting for a video signal or anything like that. It's got two perfectly flyable signals to pick from. So it's probably going to switch a lot less frequently than it might have in the past with my other antennas. But yeah, I guess I'm just going to keep doing what we're doing here and skip some of this in the video. So I might even like maybe do a little time lapse thing with it, or not time lapse, but like speed it up. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. Or maybe I'll just skip some of this and report back once we've circled the fields repeatedly and over and over and over until we have some good data. And in fact, all this is being logged on the flight controller too with ArduPilot. So we'll be able to review some of that too, as far as like the voltage drop with a 5-amp load, which is something I couldn't do with the charger when I did this stuff. You know, tested it on the workbench, tested these batteries. I was pretty much limited in how much power I could pull out of the batteries, and it kind of was a slow, a lower drain on the batteries, a smaller load on the batteries over a longer period of time, which is a little bit easier on the batteries. So the results may have been skewed by that a little bit. But we're averaging around a 5-amp load on the batteries right now, which is a little bit more realistic and kind of the number we're shooting for. So I'll be able to review the log as well at the end of this video and get a better idea of how some of that stuff looks. So for now, I'm just going to go ahead and quit talking and probably edit some of this out. And I will see you further into the flight. Alright, so we're going to cut back in for just a little bit. You see the sun is right there on the horizon. Actually, I can turn off some of my OSD here and get a better look at it. The sun is just about to set. We're currently 38 minutes into the flight at 14.9 volts. And we've used 3,300 milliamp hours. So, if I had to guess, I'd say at this point, I don't think we're going to be able to push all the way to like 8,000 or 8,500 or whatever. I think the dark is going to catch us first. Actually, I think the sun is now officially set as I was talking about it. Yeah, I don't think we're going to be able to push all the way too far into the battery. At least not as far as we'd want it to. But yeah, we're just going to keep going until the dark catches up with us. So as you see, I'm just kind of venturing out now, exploring a little bit more. Still not very far from home. I think, about 2.7 right now. We've been a little bit farther out than this, as you can see down on the map in that corner over there somewhere, that way. It's hard figuring out all this stuff. Everything's backwards. But anyway, in the bottom right-hand corner is the map. You can see we've been a little bit closer to town, but not very much. But we're going to have to start staying a little bit closer to home as it gets darker. So that once the dark starts creeping in, we can get back on the ground before it gets too dark. This time of year, once the sun sets, it gets dark really fast. But yeah, I think the dark is going to catch us out before we get to push the battery as far as we'd hope to. So I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. It's bad in a way, obviously, because we're not going to be able to test the battery as much as we'd liked. But at the same time, it's a good thing that we can take off actually a little bit earlier in the day than we normally would have. It was still a little bit rough air, windy, not terrible. But on a normal windy day, it would have been too early to fly at the point where it did take off. And we still have more than enough battery. We've not even made it halfway into what I expect to get from the battery. And we're already racing the sunset. So we may actually have to wait till the summer when we have those long, long summer evenings to be able to push the battery far enough to see what it can do in the air. So, more than capable enough. But, anyway, we're going to probably end up cutting this, and I'll come back later when we have something more exciting to report. So, I will see you in a bit. Okay, so we're just kind of checking back in with some more video. As you can see, we've now crossed the 1 hour mark. We're at 1 hour and 27 seconds, and we're at 5,137 milliamp hours used out of the battery, and we're still hovering right around 14 volts, 14.1 right now. as you can see, my camera is starting to get a little bit blurry and kind of smeary. The light is pretty low now. The sun's been set for a little while. We're probably not going to be able to get to fly too much longer, not as long as I'd hoped. Yeah. So the video, the battery performs at least as good as I was hoping. So that's a good thing. But yeah, we're probably going to have to wait for another day to push the battery to its limits and see just how far it can go. But what I'm doing right now, I noticed a couple of cars down on the roadway below. So I'm actually going to swing around and kind of get behind them, let them gain ahead of me a little bit. So I just want to kind of follow them through the woods. And just for no apparent reason, no particular reason anyway, just to have something to do. There's actually a car coming at us right now. I just passed those on the road, and he's out of view now. So yeah, we're going to follow these two cars through the woods here. Now we're cruising ground speed about 40 miles an hour, which is probably a little bit faster than they're driving on the gravel road there. Actually, one of them may have stopped, it looks like. Yeah, it seems one of them stopped on the road there below. Not sure why. But one of them kept going. It actually seems to be gaining on us a little bit. I kind of still make out his lights through the road there ahead. But yeah, I'm just kind of watching the battery voltage, because I honestly don't know what the cutoff voltage is set to on the speed controller. It's kind of something that crossed my mind a little while ago during the flight. I don't know what it's set to by default, or what it's set to now. It should be still on the defaults. I've never tweaked it. I'm not even sure what options are available. So I don't want to get caught out too far from home when the speed controller thinks the battery is dead, because it's set up for a LiPo and not a lithium ion, which kind of would be a bad thing. You'd have to go back to manual throttle control and kind of limp the airplane back home, basically keep resetting the OVC to try to get the airplane home. But yeah, I don't want to get caught in a situation like that, especially out over the wooded areas, kind of where we're flying right now. But basically, we're at 3.5 volts per cell right now, which is 14 volts. I think that's right. Yeah, my math is right. So yeah, I don't know what the LVC is set up for. So we're not going to venture out too far. Like I said, we're kind of keeping it close to home anyway. It is getting dark fast. And obviously, the camera can cope with it just fine. It hasn't even actually gone to black and white mode yet. It may in just a minute here as I turn away from the sunset. You see it starting to struggle to bring in some color now. And there's black and white, just as I expected. So yeah, we're pretty much nearing the end of this flight here. Looks like that other car might have stopped in the road there. In the woods. Kind of wondering what that's about, to be honest. Actually, it may be two vehicles stopped there. I'm not even sure. The other one seems to be coming now. We may circle back around there in just a minute and get another look at that. Kind of curious what that's about. But yeah, you can see the camera has switched to black and white mode now. And it's kind of smeary. Kind of having trouble dealing with the low light. But yeah, I think we're going to loop back around to the end of that road again. Well, not the end of the road, but the point where it exits the woods. And we seem to be hovering just fine at 14 volts. So there's 13.9 actually. But yeah, we're going to head back along the woods here. Or there's another vehicle stopped. Yeah, I think they're stopped talking to people. Or whatever. For whatever reason. It's kind of actually hard to make it out with the camera being all smeary like it is. Which it should actually improve a little bit once it gets a little bit darker than this, in fact. Which is kind of counterintuitive, but that's kind of the way it works. And now we're back to color. With a nice sunset in view. So yeah, I'm just going to stay out over the field area here. Over the open field anyway, away from the woods. And we're just going to fly back home. And go ahead and land it before it gets too dark. I'm actually going to go ahead and ramp the throttle up. And request a little bit higher ground speed. And get back home a little bit sooner. Not that we're like race in the dark or anything, but it's apparent now that we're not going to look or get the data that we're looking for anyway, as far as exactly how far we can push this battery in the air. But obviously it does perform more than adequately. So yeah, I'm just shooting straight back home now. And we're going to go ahead and land it and cut the video then. So I guess I'll take this time to... I've actually cut my throttle back now. We're not... We're just back to the same target cruise. But we're not going to... push it much further than that. But I would like to thank you for watching the video. And hopefully it wasn't too long and boring. Like I said, I'm going to cut out a lot of this so it's not... hour plus long. We've been in the air for 66 minutes now, almost 67 minutes. Yeah, we'll have to wait for a longer day to be able to push the battery to its limits. But anyway, I'm kind of losing my train of thought here as I'm managing my throttle and everything, losing altitude and preparing for my landing. We're gonna see if I can land looking into the sun. Depending on how dark the ground looks. I'm actually going to go back to fly-by-wire A.
Fly-by-wire A.
So that I can manually control my throttle as I smoothly lose altitude and set up my landing without the cruise mode fighting me on that. So I would like to thank you for watching the video. And any questions, comments, leave them in or in the comment section below. And I will try to answer them to the best of my abilities. Yeah, this camera's getting really smeary here. But I mean, I can make out my runway just fine. And of course, thank you to all the Patreons and YouTube channel members who make all this possible. And it's kind of a group effort, and it works. And I'm not sure exactly where my ground is. And there we go. Nice, smooth landing. Yeah, I don't like how smeary that video was there toward the end. I will have to take a look at that in the Caddx Retail settings. I believe that's because I have my noise reduction settings turned up a little bit too high. But anyway, I'll probably overlay some of the log from RG Plane at the end of this video. But as you can see here, as far as... Let me disarm. Slide to disarm. Slide to confirm. Okay, so there's some max values. Ground speed, 61 miles per hour, 30.2 amps. Apparently that was on takeoff. Max altitude was 309 feet. Max distance from home was 2.948 miles. And the ground covered was actually 49.06 miles. And we did that on 5,722 milliamp hours in 67 minutes and 58 seconds. So, pretty sure we can push it a lot further than that. Well, I'm not going to say a lot further than that, but definitely further than that. But I'm pretty happy with the performance, with the way it's handled it so far. But yeah, unfortunately, we didn't be able to push it all the way to the limits, but we'll see what we can do at a later date. But for now, that's been the flight. Not sure when I'll get to fly again, but when I do, you'll be the first to know. So, see you then.